you, Stephen, and thanks to everyone who's been involved in organising this today as well. And thanks to all of you for coming. As was mentioned, it's slightly chilly today, so I'm pleased that you looked out the window and still decided to come, despite the snow. As was mentioned, I'm really sorry that I can't stay for all of this. Some months ago, the regional party organised a meeting for CLP officers, which I promised I'd attend, so I'm sorry that I'm not going to be able to stay at this, but I'm pleased that we'll have the video, so at least I can catch up and watch any of them and see what we're going to be saying, and all of you as well. As was mentioned, I've got some brief notes to convey to you from Andrew and from Bob. First of all, a message from Andrew Smith, MP, which I'll just read out. Sorry if that would be a little bit boring to read it out, but anyway, it'd be much better if he was delivering it. Anyway, very sorry he can't be here. He says, "Very best wishes for a good meeting on industrial strategy. Its aims should be clear. More and better paid jobs in an environmentally responsible economy. Clearly, all the more important faced with globalisation and Brexit." And Andrew says, "We're going to need a clear and coherent framework where we improve all of the following. Education, training, retraining and apprenticeships. Information and support to people entering or re-entering work and changing jobs. Land use planning for jobs growth. The ability of communities to shape their own economic growth. Productivity and the distribution of its gains. Investment in science, innovation and support for startups. Transport infrastructure, decent housing for people to live in, including young people, enforcement of employee rights like wage, pension and equal opportunity entitlements, public procurement, export promotion, employee representation in businesses, and high quality public services." So lots to do, says Andrew. Well indeed, have a really good meeting. I look forward to working with you to carry your ideas forward. And then from Bob, Councillor Bob Price, who's the leader of Oxford City Council. He says, "On behalf of Oxford City Council Labour Group, welcome to this important seminar, which will contribute to the party's policy for government in the run-up to the 2020 general election. There's no more important policy area for us to rethink in the context of the likely exit from the European single market and the shifts in economic and trade policies in the US and the Asian economies. The UK has a very large external trade and payments deficit, which has shown little change since the post-referendum decline in the value of sterling. Substantial parts of our industrial base in motor vehicles, steel, food manufacturing and energy are foreign owned and hence subject to locational and investment decisions taken on a global basis. The government's sectoral support policy, as recently outlined in the Green Paper, together with a redesign of the skills strategy, is a weak response to a critical issue. The Labour Party has to tackle the regional imbalances in the UK economy head on, promote competitive new industries based on the innovations which are emerging from our outstanding HE and research institutions, and have a fundamental rethink about our skills and education systems to make them fit for 21st century technologies. Enjoy the day," says Bob. So now, goodness, I don't know how I can add my tuppence worth to their very eloquent comments. But I just wanted to reflect a little bit really on where the Conservatives are now and then where I think we can go as a Labour Party. I was astonished but pleased to find out that the term industrial policy is now allowed in government. Sajid Javid, of course, seemed to be completely allergic to using that phrase, and I understand he banned his civil servants from using that phrase, just as they have been banned from using the phrase regional policy before as well, which now seems to be re-entering our lexicon. I'm very pleased about that. We're also seeing in government documents now mention of many of the policy areas that we've pushed as a Labour Party for a very long time. They're saying that we should learn from the Small Business Administration in the US, something of course pushed by Chuka Amana when he was the Shadow Business Secretary. Also, they say that we need to have more relevant vocational qualifications and more and better apprenticeships. Well, again, our husband's review said exactly that only a couple of years ago. And the Green Paper that's just out says we need to rebalance the economy across the country. Well, yes, some of us came to that conclusion a very long time ago and have been pushing concrete measures to do that. And it also says we need to improve the availability of business finance. Well, again, something that we've pushed through much more concrete measures than some of the quite woolly words in the Green Paper, and particularly through our policy of having regional investment banks as well as the British Business Bank. But I am very concerned about a number of the gaping holes that exist at the moment in the government's industrial strategy. There's so many of these, I barely know where to start. First of all, thinking about green energy, green technology, many, many warm words about that. But we know the track records that we've had recently, where we've had massive, huge U-turns concerns in government policy, which have put, not to mention thousands of people out of jobs, particularly in home insulation, but which has sucked investment out of green energy and energy efficiency, because investors just don't know what the policy context is going to be in the future. When they've gone from a situation of subsidy for renewables to virtually no subsidy at all in a very, very short time period. Again, trade unions almost completely absent from the government's, well, in fact, entirely absent, sorry, from the government's industrial strategy. I'm sure we'll hear more about that. Despite the talk in the Green Paper about work-based learning, when we know it's trade unions that deliver a lot of that, despite the mention of the need for good industrial relations, new working practices, when again it's trade unions that deliver a lot of that. And of course we've got a great example of that in this city with BMW, an incredibly productive plant, and one which is benefiting from trade unions having a good relationship with management. And also, of course, there's the new rhetoric around localisation, but where is the concrete action in that regard, particularly for places like Oxford? There's mention of metro mayors, new devolution settlements, of course all of those going on behind closed doors, not part of the democratic process, not part of a consultation for all of us to take part in. Seems to be now that you can sort out the situation for your local authority by texting a SPAD for a government minister rather than actually engaging in something more democratic. And finally, of course, a total failure to engage with the elephant in the room, which is our exit from the European Union. Reading the Green Paper when it came out, I just felt that many of the measures were frankly slightly risible given the huge amount of uncertainty that our government has pushed us into. You know, not because of the referendum vote itself, but because of the extreme approach that they're taking to our new relationship with the rest of the EU. I mean, it's all very well for the government to say the need for us to have a focus on nuclear research into the future when they've said that they're going to pull us out of Euratom. You know, why? Because the European Court of Justice is involved in quite a tangential extent, actually, with Euratom. They're going to pull us out of that. No mention of the potential impact that will have on the Cullum experiment just down the road from here. Hundreds of jobs, you know, lots of spin-out business that's come out of that. No consideration of that. Again, talking about rebalancing our economy with no long-term strategy for what they'll do about us losing structural funds. The one source of money available to many local councils in depressed areas that was focused on need, that was genuinely responsive to some of the problems that come from deprivation. I'm not saying it was perfect, but we don't have a decent forward-looking plan for what will take place. In relation to structural funds. Also no indication of what we'll do when we don't have access to the European Investment Bank. You know, they talk about the smart meters project in the Green Paper, funded through the European Investment Bank. Of course, in this city, the biggest ever loan to a higher education institution from the European Investment Bank to Oxford University. What are we going to do without that kind of funding in the future? And just finally, I find the whole talk of sectoral deals that the government is pushing, they're pretty bizarre when they seem to be hurtling headlong to an extreme version of Brexit where we won't have that tariff-free access to trade potentially, and where we'll have lots of potentially new tariff barriers. I mean, they say in the Green Paper that around automotive, for example, and other sectors, that these different sectors, they should consider how they can help address market access barriers with other countries. I mean, come on, you know, committing us to genuine access to the single market would maybe help a little bit in that regard, and not sacrificing our country's interests because of an ideological commitment to cutting immigration, which doesn't actually reflect the views of many Leave voters, would help. We really need to have that stronger commitment to preserving our access to the single market. But I think all of this, it actually gives us a good opportunity as a Labour Party. It gives us an opportunity to surface those issues about how we're really going to deliver on devolution that's meaningful, that's democratic, and that's based on an open process, not one cooked up behind closed doors. It gives us a genuine opportunity to talk about green technologies in the future, where we have regulatory stability, where we have a genuine commitment to supporting renewable technology. And it also gives us a chance to talk about what kind of new trade deals we want, how we're going to make those trade deals democratic, how we're going to stop them from threatening our public services. I thought it was really telling that when we had our Prime Minister go over and hold hands and whatnot with Donald Trump, that she hasn't, after that, promised to rule out liberalising our health service as part of a new trade deal with the rest of the, with the US. That's not where the growth in our economy is going to come in the future. We need to have that discussion about trade policy, about democratic, just trade policy for the 21st century. So I'm sorry that I'm not going to be here with you for the rest of today to get all of your ideas about how to do that, but do always feel free to get in contact with me on any of them, and I'm pleased that I'll be able to catch up with the proceedings through the video link. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for that, Anneliese. Anneliese is able to take a couple of questions before she has to go, so if anybody wants to put any questions or raise any issues that arise out of that fantastic overview of where we're at the moment, I'm impressing. Anybody? Yes?
Yes, I'm wondering about globalisation, because it seems to me to be a huge problem. It's gone on to only been developing, now people are really seeing it, what it is, when other countries saw it a long time ago. And if it's so harmful, is there any way that Britain, with a suitable government, could do something about it?
Any other questions? Yes, I'm running back. Just tell us who they are.
And again, if you like, if you've already made your views known on what we're not here, but how do you say how that would affect local jobs and services and local democracy and the best way of opposing it?
I'd like to make a question. After Brexit, how we can mitigate the risks, for example, for automotive industry in Spain? Because we know we have a lot of automotive industry in the UK. All the process and the impact is still here, the produced here, and how we can mitigate after the high risks in this sector.
Right. Can we take three at a time and then another three?
Thank you very much for all your probing questions. I mean, first of all, in relation to globalisation, I would say it does depend a bit on what you define globalisation as. If we're talking about cultural exchange and people being able to move more freely, I think that's something that I, as a socialist, really want to promote. And I think that's a really, really good thing. And actually, that, sadly, is one of the main elements of globalisation that people like Trump want to counteract and they want to stop, because they realise that when people have got autonomy and when they've got access to other cultures, they become powerful and they become autonomous and they can challenge authority. And I think that's what he and people like him don't like. However, other interpretations of globalisation, if we say it's the same thing as, you know, neoliberalism or that kind of interpretation, I think, if I'm honest, you know, socialists and social democrats haven't necessarily thought deeply enough about how we can control those developments to work for us. And that's where I think the debate is now. I personally don't think it's about whether we want globalisation or we don't want it. It's about how we can control it. Jude Kirkton-Darling, who's one of my colleagues in the European Parliament, she has led for us for some time on some of the big trade deals. And she said, really, what's at question here is not whether we have international trade, because a lot of the time it's very positive for us to have that international trade. It's about who it works for, who it delivers for. One of the big problems that we have had and that I've had with some of the deals like CETA is that the positive impact on the economy hasn't been demonstrated, and most of the liberalisation that was suggested would actually be in the public sector potentially, and not a clear enough demonstration being provided of what the controls would be to make sure they'll still be democratically responsive. That would be my response to that question. Around one Oxfordshire, I mean, I'll be completely honest here, I've got kind of my own interests on this, okay, so my partner is a city councillor, so, you know, take it with a pinch of salt. But I do think, personally, it is a bit of a disgrace that in this city, Now we can talk about whose responsibility it is. In this city, we have, on some educational indicators, we are, is it 360, about 364 local authorities or something, on some educational indicators, in one of the richest cities in Britain. Now, fine, that's partly because of people pulling their kids out and putting them in private schools, okay, I accept that, but nonetheless, there's something that isn't working here. And I think if we had clearer control in this city, we would make things more responsive. I mean, just one example would be actually, particularly kind of post-Brexit, I've been working with a number of people in this room, and I'm grateful to them for that, on how we can try and protect our science here in Oxfordshire after Brexit. Now, I find the City Council to be fully on board. You know, they're working really hard on this, they've produced a strategy on it, they're talking to lots of different stakeholders, thinking how they can use any spare funds they've got, my goodness, they haven't got many, but you know, what they can do to support that, how they can make European migrants living here, scientists, feel welcome, so they stay here, stay providing that economic activity. What have I got from the county council on that? Very, very, very little, I'll be honest. Now, I think that's just an indication of how activist the different authorities are. And I'm not saying that's going to be the same everywhere. So in some areas, I think unitaries could work, but I'm not sure that they would here, certainly on the basis of what we've had until now. Question about the automotive industry, I think is a really, really good one. Of course, it's a really challenging one for us here. I know that people here are actually working in plants, so we'll probably get into more discussion on that potentially later on. And you know, any thoughts people have on that, do let me know, and I can do what I can to push them. I'm very concerned really about the nature of the debate that we've had around automotive so far. The first worry that I had was when we had David Davis saying, oh well, if we don't get a good deal, we'll just slap some tariffs onto German cars coming into Britain. Now that is not a way to make friends and influence people, right? And we've got to underline the interdependency between our economies. Now I know it's a challenge for firms like BMW and others. Many of the new rules around freedom of movement, particularly where they're going to make it difficult to bring in specialists, that's going to be a real challenge. And you know, they don't have massive margins, so they're thinking, well, something is going to make our products more expensive and our processes more expensive. That might just tip location decisions somewhere else. So it's good the government is trying at least to have some kind of impetus behind this sector deal for automotive. But the question is, where's the money backing this up? Where are the genuine new policies backing it up? There doesn't seem to me to be enough of a focus on the supply chain, and actually some of the initiatives under Labour that focused on that were got rid of, right, by the last business secretary. So how can we build those up again? And finally, what we really shouldn't be doing is, you know, whether it happened or not, given the impression that there's been a sweetheart deal with one part of the automotive industry, is actually going to, I think, potentially put off particularly foreign manufacturers from staying here, because they'll think there isn't a coherent government strategy, instead there's backroom deals.
Thanks very much. Thanks a lot, Anneliese. Unfortunately, I see the time that Anneliese has got to go now, can't stay for further questions, but as Anneliese says, she's always accessible for anybody who has a point that she wants to raise, and it's very sad that we won't have the benefit of her input in the European Parliament in the future. Very
active
questions like tax dodging and so on. However, as has been said, we'll be at least 2 years to go, and who knows. Anyway, thanks very much, Anneliese.